Good morning.
Good afternoon.
Good evening.
And good night.
And I would love a fourth meal because I didn't even really have dinner tonight.
What? You didn't have dinner?
No,
you
came
always,
straight
you
here.
You always do a dinner before you come here. You always do some kind of meal or something.
Why do you think that? I actually don't think I ate this week or last time.
Every time before you come, you go, oh, I'll be over there. I just got to eat.
Oh, I did do that last time, right?
Yeah, you don't know how to eat and run.
Like Nori.
Grab a slice.
I'm not Nori.
Yeah.
No, I'm all during the week I basically starve myself, so it's hard. I have to arrange the meal properly. If it was the weekend, I don't care cuz I'm just shoveling whatever comes right down my gullet.
Right.
But
during the week you keep it mellow.
I keep it pretty hardcore. Mm. Like almost probably there's probably some deep emotional problems here to the way
I'm too, but I go the other way.
Just eat all the time.
Yeah. I mean not in the last 2 weeks.
Not eating the last 2 weeks?
Yeah.
But you going back to
I don't know what I'm going
to do. A little reset?
Sure.
Cipha, real quick before we get to our guest, is everything okay with you this week? You and time this week was a little, there were some things going on there.
Me and time?
Yeah.
Oh, you talking about, no. Me and, no, you and time.
By the way, in this very, because I'm always wrong, I gave you the win just assuming I was wrong.
Okay.
I went back and read the text.
Yeah, what did it say?
You were actually at least not right.
Okay.
I said, what's up? Do we have time tonight? Whatever. You said, sure. I said, cool. I'm around after 8 p.m.
Okay.
You said, okay. I hit you at 8:10 and you acted like I had flaked on the whole night.
So
I said after 8.
You're missing a part.
Okay.
You said we should do 20 minutes.
Right.
So that's 8 to 8:20 to me. To me, that's 8 to 8:20. You still weren't on at 8:16.
Well, I was having, by the way, I ended up having a huge technical problem. So it worked out for the best. No, it's okay. I think I figured it out.
Yeah.
But anyways, that was our small time glitch.
Yeah.
Then you got another one wrong where you're running Shawn J Period.
Wait, 1 second. Thank you so much. Love you so much. Here's the deal. No, my window, now that I got this job, you know I got that job, right?
I know you do.
You know I got that job.
I know. You're at 94.7 The Block. I listen. You notice me texting you and listening?
94.7 The Block, New York's number one for throwbacks.
I've heard that.
My windows are tiny now, bro.
And believe me, I know.
My windows are tiny.
Your job's the bane of my existence.
So I respect that. So I only have but so much time with the kids.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and the time with the kids is bullshit. It's feeding, showering.
Not even fun.
Not even fun.
By the way, did you even notice the shot Emilio took at you in our chat?
No.
When you said.
What did he say?
When you were being a dick about time and you said, I've got kids. And Emilio wrote, since when? Anyways, the windows are tight.
Yeah.
Things get complicated.
We're going to get it.
But listen, we're so far. We're still rolling. We haven't missed a beat so far.
We out here.
Knock on wood.
Shout out to the WANAP fans that came to my show in Richmond, Virginia.
You were just saying something about your WANAP fans.
I got mad. I kind of yelled at some WANAP fans.
Excuse me? Why would you do such a thing?
There was one guy with a guy who wasn't a WANAP fan. And there was another guy by himself.
What do you mean?
He was sitting, he bought one ticket.
This is Richmond, Virginia?
Yeah, he came to the comedy show by himself. And I screamed at the WANAP. I said, yo, y'all got to start bringing some chicks around.
You've been screaming this at WANAP people for years, bro. It's never going to happen.
What do you mean? You can't come by yourself. You look like a psycho. But I respect to the guy that came through. Shout out to Bryce. Mm-hmm. Bryce is a DJ down there in Richmond. He came to the show.
Oh, I know Bryce.
Yeah.
Bryce. He sends me clean records every week.
Yes.
He said that.
Yes.
Yeah, that's my dude.
Great guy.
Is Bryce white?
Never, not at all.
Really?
Nowhere near.
I liked him even more now.
Yeah.
I assumed he was like another version of me.
No.
Of course, I am disgusted by.
I know nothing. This is what I'm, from what the, when I met him, what it seems like he's one of those blacks that's kind of white.
I don't like what you're saying. No, but I assumed he was a white, like, college radio nerd.
No, black.
He's a black college radio nerd.
Black nerd, yeah.
Yes.
A blurred, whatever. He was great. And then there was another guy there who was, who had his wife with him.
Okay.
And I got into the whole, I said, hold on, he forces you to listen to WANAP in the car or in the crib. Now he forced you to come to the show. And she goes, it's his birthday.
That's very nice. Thank you very much, lady.
So after I talked to them after the show, I only spoke to 1UP fans after the show.
Really?
Yeah, I didn't talk to them. But I told, I would wait for them and I'd be like, hey, psst, hey, come here. Come over here.
And by the way, how did you know they were all 1UP fans?
Bro, I'd go, yo, how long you been listening to me? And he goes, years ago.
Oh.
Well. Years ago. And I go, and then I turn my back to the crowd and I go, who did I used to DJ for? And two guys go, Little Kim.
That's it. And so you know your people.
And then I go, what is the current relationship status of Rosenberg? And they go, divorced.
Oh, no, I'm engaged now. They're still saying divorced until I get married again.
I don't know.
Am I always going to be divorced?
I don't know.
All right.
But anyway. Yeah,
without any further ado.
Love those guys. Love you, man. Thank you.
Shout out to the one. Do you have anything you need to... We'll deal with your plugs later.
No. This is after.
And by the way, to everyone who's on the Patreon, we love you. Shout out to our Patreon people. Patreon.com/JuanEpIsLife. In fact, there may be parts from today's big interview that you only get on Patreon.
Yeah.
We'll see. But without any further ado, Cipha, let's bring in our guy.
Are you respecting my beds on 94.7 The Block?
I haven't really been paying attention to the beds.
You didn't hear eight Steps to Perfection?
No, you
Company
did.
Company
Flow? Oh, you did it?
You didn't hear Day One?
D-I-T-Z?
Digging in crates?
No.
Yo, my beds are fire.
Well, you can't put your headphones on so you can even hear what I'm playing here.
Okay.
Came up last week, 2 weeks in a row. And these 30 seconds of this song is why we'll eventually have to delete this episode. And the man who made this record, Shawn J Period, on the show. Welcome aboard,
thank
man.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for having me.
So how did this come about? Did L hit you, or did someone tell you that he talked about you on the podcast? Did you like hear it? How did this end up working out?
A couple of people, a couple of friends were texting me, and then Kelsey, who came with me today, he actually said, man, he mentioned, then I saw L, spoke to L. So a couple of people, you know, friends outside of the business and also, you know, L as well.
So first of all, you're in Brooklyn, correct?
Queens. So he had a couple of...
There's a couple of...
Yeah, so
I got a fact check. Got a fact check. Okay.
So Queens.
Queens. I used to be in Brooklyn, though.
So. And where are you originally from?
Outside of Richmond. So, Richmond.
I was just in Richmond.
Yeah.
I was just there.
So you were right about that.
You nailed that part.
The only person I hit, I said, well, who I know in Richmond? I hit Mad Skills. I go, yo, I'm doing a show down there.
I don't think he's there.
He goes, I live in LA.
That's it. Yeah, I found that out too.
Damn.
Last year.
Yeah, he's like, I live in LA. I was like, all right, we'll send your family.
Well, do you know where the Ha Ha Hole is? Where did you play?
No. He was describing it. And I was like,
Sandman's Comedy Club.
You don't know where Sandman's Comedy Club is?
No. I go back, but, you know, I'm not out. Like that.
Yeah, okay.
Sure.
How long you been in New York now?
Since we were signed with Down South. So we moved in 92.
Oh, so you...
I've been living here longer than I was in Virginia.
Yeah, okay.
I thought you're a New Yorker now.
I thought I heard you moved back down south back in the day. You never did?
No.
Okay.
Yeah, I thought I heard that too.
I was in Brooklyn. I was actually in Clinton Hill. One street over from Biggie. That's when we moved. We literally moved. He was on St. James. We were on Cambridge Place.
Wait, this is when you moved to Brooklyn?
Moved to Brooklyn.
And he was there still?
Yeah, yeah. The DJ.
In 92.
We actually saw him, you know, because we were signed. I mean, we'll obviously get into this, but we were signed by Stretch, you know, Stretch and Bobito, right? So, but Biggie wasn't even signing. It was, I think Matty C, all of them were friends, right?
So right,
You know, but Biggie was still on the block. You know, in the Junior Mafia, I'm assuming we're runners or whatever. You know,
whatever. How does Richmond do get a deal?
All right, before we even get into it all, just to get a preview, because one thing Cipha and I have been really, something we enjoy is how like we interview all these underground legends. I assume you're not offended by that terminology.
No.
Who have these brush ups against really huge stars?
Yeah.
Like, so you have a big. Is that the closest you got to Biggie? Was that, or was there ever any other interaction?
We interacted with them. I mean, obviously, they were on, let's say, Washington or whatever, right? Where the subway was.
Right.
So we would always see them when we were getting off the subway, you know. And it was like, "What's up?" But you know, nothing. And then when they got signed. When he got, you know, he was with Puffy, and then we were doing, I think it was the Village Vanguard or something, like just some kind of promo show, and he was hosting it. And then...
Hosted it?
Yeah.
Puffy?
No, Biggie.
Biggie.
Yeah, Biggie hosted a show?
Wow, yeah. What?
It was just like a promo show, different artists and stuff. So then He was on Cambridge Place with someone in the car, and then we came up, and then we had performed the song "Tractors, Rakes, and Hoes," which, as I've gotten older, I'm, you know, not proud of calling women hoes. You know what I mean?
We understand.
Yeah, yeah. But so then we're coming down the street, about to go in the house, and then Biggie's in the car, and he yells out the window, "Tractors, Rakes, and Hoes," right? And we're like, you know what I mean?
That's
so
crazy.
Yeah. So.
But, there you go.
We had many interactions.
I don't want to hear it yet, but were there any Jay-Z interactions?
No.
No Jay-Z interactions?
That I know of, no.
I know were there J Dilla interactions?
One, okay. Actually.
Only one. Interesting. Because right, cool. You guys were contemporaries. No, I'm just getting a preview, a little preview.
Oh, all right,
so let's do this.
Thumbnail.
Okay.
Forget it.
When you hover over the porno and you see, like, well, hold on. You're a good Christian, man. But, Cipha, I'm with you. You hover over and you see dirty things happening.
He said pover.
Pover. You get the idea. Yeah. So, okay. I was very amused and sort of surprised because I thought we knew our audience.
Yes.
And then in the Discord, mad people were like, I never even heard of Artifacts.
Yeah. Wow.
And I was kind of like.
Which I love and I hate at the same time because we're reaching.
More people.
Yeah, but
more,
like,
people.
Right. Yeah, so I think we have a problem of assuming what everything we love, our fans will love. So we're going to have to do a little more explaining sometimes.
So what I was going to say to start this off, Shawn J. Period.
Sure.
You sit down on a plane. I'm sure this has happened. Mm-hmm. Some very polite white woman strikes up a conversation with you.
That's my dream.
She's on her way to a conference in Bethlehem, Pennsylvania.
Yeah, what does she do? She does sales.
Is this turning
right?
you on? Yeah.
She does sales?
Yeah, so I've calmed down.
Like educational software or something.
And she says, well, what do you do for a living? Mm-hmm. And then you say, I make music. And she goes, oh my God, my son loves hip hop. Who are some of the people you've worked for? What do you do? What is the elevator pitch for what Shawn J. Period has done in hip hop?
I tend to start with Mos Def because... Yep. He was, you know, because of his acting, you know, and then go from there. So Mos Def is usually the one of the people. And then, you know, I can go into Q-Tip, you know, when I work with him with the Body Rock song and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And then the Artifacts, even though super, like you said, most people, you know, unless you're into it, won't know. You know what I mean?
Guess you're right.
And then I say Beastie Boys sometimes, like, because I did a remix for them when they were doing that anthology album DVD or whatever they were doing. When it had like a slew of remixes on it,
Mos Def would make sense. That's an interesting starting point. Did you do a Black Star album cut too?
Two.
Which ones?
Children's
Story and Hater Players. Huh. And fun fact, and someone pointed this out in the Black History Museum in DC, but the album cover itself, Tim Ronan and whoever was doing the album covers for Rawkus, if you look at. You'll see Mos and Talib.
For Black Star album?
Black Star album, right. So you'll see Mos and Talib. And then right below them, really small, you'll see a picture of me and a picture of Hi-Tech. Because I was considered Mos producer. Hi-Tech was considered.
Oh, really? I never even noticed that.
Yeah. And when they told me, so then when we went, my family and I, we went down to the Black History Museum. And obviously that's one of the... album covers
right in
there. So I took a picture with it right next to it, like, you know.
Oh, that's, I never even realized that.
I didn't, like I said, until years later someone pointed it out.
You didn't even know when it came out?
No. I mean, they just put, you know, albums.
Hilarious.
And that was right when I actually stopped. They went kind of away. I got married. I kind of was pulling back, from the scene and stuff like that.
Yeah.
You know.
All right, so let's get to how the Down South. Let's start with the Down South piece of it all. Down South was a group signed to Big Beat Atlantic. Is that
Big
right?
Big Beat Atlantic, yes.
So you're down there in Richmond, Virginia.
Yeah. Are all of you guys from Richmond?
Mayur, the DJ, he's actually from New York.
Okay.
But he moved to Richmond. At some point in his life.
And how many people were in Down South? Three of you, right?
Three. Yeah.
And who's the third gentleman?
Jeremy. Soda Pop would be his name.
Okay. Yeah. Y'all all still friends?
Yeah, of course.
Like family.
But, you know, obviously, and you know, being in the business has this miraculous thing of just kind of, you know, they'll highlight one and then all of a sudden the group kind of dissipates and stuff. So we went through things like that. But overall, we're good. For sure.
And were you rapping in the group also?
Rapping, yeah.
Okay, that was you rapping, yeah. Because you did all the music. Or did all of you do the music?
I was the main one doing the music. And then we had four... We had the B-Nuts and T-Ray and Rob did a song, I think, and Stretch. And, you know,
there's a Beat Nuts joint on the Down South album?
They did a slew of them. Like, yeah, it was between like Beat Nuts and T-Ray. They did multiple.
T-Ray.
Yeah.
Name keeps coming up.
Keeps coming up.
Yo, it's T-Ray. You talk to T-Ray?
No. L, I think.
L does. Oh, L told us he did. Mm-hmm. We got to bother L for T-Ray.
I told you, we working on it.
We working on it?
Keather talks to him.
Working on it. Really?
That's T-Ray's doing some, like, the Venice thing. With, yeah. Like, this, yeah, he's interesting stuff.
What are some of the ones the Beat Nuts did on the Lost in Brooklyn album?
Oh man, I gotta remember the names. If I hear them, I mean you could tell. I know they did. They did Lost in Brooklyn. Actually, the title.
Interesting. Let's take a gander. Oh, I would have never guessed that's Beat Nuts. I'm joking.
We got Lost in Brooklyn. Yeah.
What year is this?
It was 90, by the time it was released,
early
95. Oh, no. Yeah, we got signed in 92. It took us about 3 years to do it. So by the time it was 2 years, 3 years roughly, yeah. 94, 95.
That's crazy.
Listen, I don't want to argue with the artist who's in the group. I'm confident this album was latest released in 94.
Okay, maybay. Yeah.
No, very confident.
Okay.
I mean, did I ever tell you about the time I got into an argument with Questlove when I was in college? Mm-mm. About it, like he performed, and I was like, oh, after their show, I like was able to interview him because I was a college radio person, and I'm like, oh, Quest, do you remember when you performed at the blah 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 with so and so and so and so? And he goes, no, it wasn't with so and so, it was with so and so. I went, no, it was with so and so, and he went, I'm in the group.
Yeah,
it was with so and so. I was like, I hear you. But I was there. It sums up my annoying, white, privileged, shut up, I know.
Did you ever figure out if you were right?
And that's why
I know I was right.
That's why I gave the window, 94, 95.
See, I appreciate that. Okay, so like you guys formed as a group in Richmond. How were you all? You all were all friends? Just like high school friends?
Jeremy and I are cousins.
Okay.
First cousins.
Legit and cousins?
Legit.
Legit first cousins.
Legit.
Sorry, legit cousins.
Who's related?
Jeremy.
Your mother and your brother and
fathers, her, fathers.
Both your fathers are brothers.
Yes.
Blood, same mother, blood, same father.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay. So did you and Jeremy?
I don't know why I'm interrogating him.
No, I think it's important we know.
And then Mayor, he actually was a friend of mine in high school. He went to a couple of high schools in Richmond, and then he came to our high school, Verina High School, the senior year.
Okay.
And look, you had to imagine, you know, the age of Albie Shore and stuff, the light skinned guys we had, you know, had our run. And then you could imagine this was when let's say the African Beads, and he's from, I think his family's from Gambia or somewhere like that, right? So he comes in on senior year.
Yeah.
And he just was wrecking. Wow. Like everybody, all the girls were falling all over him. But we connected because he was a DJ.
Right.
So, you know what I mean? And just, you know.
Was he one of those New Yorkers that moves down south but constantly says he's from New York?
No.
He wasn't?
He's super cool.
He was cool.
That is most everyone.
Yeah. Because
shout out to my brother, Quarterman. You know Quarterman. I mean, because listen, in Brooklyn, you know, yeah, we do things in Brooklyn. Yeah. And by the way, Q has now been in Maryland for, he went to Maryland when he was 18. He's now 44. And he's still talking about Brooklyn.
Not at all.
Wasn't one of those guys. By the way, I don't want to disrespect you.
Okay.
It was 94. Of course I was right.
Oh, wow.
Okay.
Wow.
And my window worked.
Yeah, your window hit. And I also knew it had to be. Had to be. That was my period where when the Down South album came out was my period in hip hop when I would try to buy like every CD that like I saw an ad and a review and saw the video. So if I saw an ad and review in the Source and I'd seen the singles video a couple times, I'm basically in.
You're right. Okay. You're getting it.
Okay.
Yeah. Like, oh, Fesu's releasing Blind, Cripple, and Crazy. I need this.
You're in there.
Right. Papa Chuck is releasing his album. I need it.
I don't even know what you're saying.
What did you do with all those albums?
That's a good question. So a lot of them are around. The problem is, as I started collecting vinyl seriously, the CDs kind of all just became like all over the place. But I'll look for the Papa Chuck album if you're curious.
No, that's okay.
So how did you end up getting signed by Stretch? How'd they discover you?
So Mayor, being from New York, he interned at Def Jam. So his...
Mayor.
Fat Farm, Russell Simmons Mayor.
I know. Yeah, Mayor. That's crazy.
So he was.
Wait, so he came back up to New York after Richmond?
Yeah, he would come for intern and, you know, during the summers and, right. and Christmas and, you know,
right. summer, summer. Oh, and my Lord, so, that's crazy.
So he was interning there and his aunt. Oh, well, I don't know if it's real aunt or play aunt.
Okay, say, okay, okay.
Or cousin, always whatever. A debate between real and play. Yeah, let's be honest.
Yes, okay. Yes, it's true. But she was Carmen Asher's Watson. So I think she ended up running Def Jam for a time and was wow. working with Rush Communications. So he got an intern, but he and internship, but he and Bobito were there. So that's how the demo got to.
So Bob was working at Def Jam
correct,
at the time.
Correct.
So he's like, I live in Richmond. I got a group.
Here's yeah, a group. Yeah, but yeah. But I mean, obviously he's there rubbing shoulders with them and eating lunch and whatever they're doing, right?
Yeah.
Promoting, you know. And then so obviously that's the connection to Stretch because Bob and Stretch had the radio show.
Of course.
So y'all, I assume you guys got to go do the radio show too.
Yes.
How was that?
It was great. Yeah, it was great. I mean, but for me, like, I didn't know, you know, for people here who grew up, they know the magnitude of the show. I just saw it as, well, this is Stretch that wants to sign us and Bob, and they're up there acting crazy. And you know what I mean?
Right.
It was good.
You know? It's funny. I didn't fully understand how big a thing Stretch and Bob was in New York until I was a little bit older, like until I'd been at Maryland for a while, college for a while right. and met New York, like spent time with New York hip hop heads.
Right, right.
It's not like, outside of New York, Stretch and Bob did not resonate the way, like, if you'd said Marley Marl, obviously, which is commercial. It makes right. sense. Like, the commercial yeah. DJs were more known,
right.
obviously. And then you start spending time with New Yorkers, you're like, yo, this Stretch and Bob thing.
Right.
Do you remember, was anyone else on the same day you guys were on?
We went there multiple times because it was just, you know.
Of course you did.
I mean, Stretch, though, we would go to Nell's with Stretch. I mean, we were basically with Stretch a lot, you know, when he would go DJing and stuff like that. So we may have gone there for the show, but we would go there, you know.
We just go hang out.
Yeah, hang out and stuff.
Yeah,
so,
these are your people.
Yeah, and I mean, not from my understanding, like, were we there when Wu-Tang? It was like, I remember Wu-Tang came from Staten Island. It was a number of things, you know. We were there multiple times.
So. And how much did you produce on the first album?
Probably about half.
About half.
Yeah, about half, yeah.
And what was the first outside thing you did?
Wait, no, wait, hold on. Let me get nerdy. What were you up on there? Let me think of your style. I'm gonna say MPC.
No. I think he's an ASR guy.
In the ballpark, EPS 16 plus.
Oh wow.
Plus.
Wow.
I'm gonna laugh and nod like I know what they're talking about.
It's before the ASR.
It's the pre ASR.
Yeah.
Right.
Got it. Okay.
Yeah. So you know, and that's what we cut the demo on. And I mean, even that piece lasted all the way through Mos Def, and you know, I added on ASP 1200 to it and stuff like that.
But, here's what I want to know. Like, all of these groups that have a deal that had deals with majors and subsidiaries at that time all have stories and hopes and dreams. And obviously, it didn't happen for everybody.
Sure.
And, you know, when you guys signed, I mean, were you just like over the moon? Like, yo, we're about to be fucking out of here?
Of course. And you had to think that the South had a nice little run. You had Arrested Development. You had, you know, any of the groups that were coming out of Atlanta and etc. So it was a good time for a Southern group.
Right? Why not? Why not Richmond?
Yeah, right. You know, and to the point where we went through the whole process of naming ourselves. Like we started out as the J Team because all of our last names start with J. And then from there, it took us a long time to come up with a name. So finally, down South, it made sense. The Southern.
Wait, did you make the name up in New York?
In New York, yeah.
Because I could imagine everybody talking to you when they find out where you're from. They're like, "Oh, you from down South?"
Yeah. It ultimately became that simple. But I mean, we were coming up with all kinds of names, you know. And then finally, you know, we landed on that name. And then the whole Austin Brooklyn had to do more with Jeremy and I getting lost in New York, like, you know, learning the New York subway systems, et cetera, et cetera. So
got it. Yeah. So you guys really leaned in with the whole down South name. You're like, we might as well go for it.
Yeah.
By the way, Cipha, you know, I DM'd with Speech for Arrested Development this week.
Really?
Yeah, why not? Has anyone?
Why
ever,
not?
We should get Speech on the show, bro.
You have to.
Yo, Arrested Development was friggin' big for a minute, and I don't ever hear from them.
Did he ask you to take him to another place?
No, he didn't. Oh. He said he just wanted to be treated regular because he's just, you know, everyday people.
Right, I understand that.
That's good.
Yeah. I like doing. I dare you to come up with one more.
Well, because he was down with the revolution.
Oh.
And now he lives in Tennessee.
There you go. We made it all the way around. So, what were the big moments? Obviously, the signing's big. You know,
You got signed first before you started producing for other people?
Oh, yes, definitely.
Okay, so you would, you got signed and through Stretch.
Stretch, correct.
So you had signed through his whatever.
It was actually Craig Coleman, who, interestingly
enough. It was Craig Coleman. Stretch was just the A&R.
A&R, yeah.
Oh, so it wasn't his label.
No.
Okay, so he signed you.
Correct.
And then.
And Craig Coleman just flamed out. That was it. He left. He never did anything else in the industry again.
No, he's pretty big.
He's still I think he runs Atlantic. Yeah, I think he absolutely runs the entire label.
Did you see a shout out on the Grammys?
No, it was probably more than one. Which one?
No, literally there was like a moment where they were like, oh, I don't know what the shout out was. It was some kind of like. The Warner Music and like Julie and Craig Coleman are just, I was like, this is crazy. Like the label execs are getting shouted at the Grammys.
But shouted by the, like by MC Lyte?
By Trevor. And they went, they showed him in the audience.
Wow. And he said them by name?
Yes. It was crazy. I'm like, this is a weird shout out. Like,
I have to say one thing right now, and neither of you have to co-sign what I'm about to say. But it needs to be said.
Is it going
to
be anti-Semitic?
No.
Oh, okay.
But, if anyone else in my feed makes me watch Trevor Noah rapping to Busta Rhymes again, I'm gonna kill someone.
It's pretty cool.
it's okay. Okay.
What? How?
It's fine. Every time they see, I feel like
Can you spit that verse?
No, I didn't even remember what.
Are
verse
you
it was.
Are you a half black half white kid from apartheid South Africa?
How
did he even get the album?
It's
an album cut.
Well, hold on. Didn't apartheid end in '94?
Huh?
Busta's album came out after apartheid. Yeah. So the
you think wait, apartheid,
did apartheid mean there were no albums in South Africa even?
Of course there was.
You think apartheid ended and then everything was great the next day?
I don't think this has anything to do with
have
apartheid.
Have you ever heard of sharecroppers? Everything wasn't fine. The next day was still rough and rugged.
Listen, I appreciate Trevor Noah's experience. I've heard his biography is amazing. I just don't need to see him rap to Busta Rhymes again.
I really appreciated that moment.
But how many times did it come on your timeline?
Well, touche.
The first time I appreciated it, and then when everyone kept posting it over and over again,
how excited he was!
I was like, okay, Natalie could at one point do his entire "Look at Me Now" verse. Everyone could.
Yeah, but that's a single that was on the radio all the time.
But it's a harder rap to do,
right?
This guy was doing an album cut. You gotta respect it, man. Hip hop.
If he done do the bus a bus, I'd respect it more. What album cut was it again?
Was it a
see all this
party over here? Was it party over?
Oh, I think it was.
Was that saying? That's on.
Well, by then, guess what?
What?
It wasn't a fucking album cut, was it?
It's an album cut.
Party is going on over here. Yeah. Became a single.
Yeah, but later.
So you should be ashamed.
Not a big single. Not a big single.
But I remember it. Right, damn it! And you know, you can see that you have Fast Sean's a DJ. He was like, "Yeah, it was. It was a single." He knew right away. All right, so what were some of the big moments besides getting signed? Like, do you remember getting played on the radio? First time it was on Rap City. What were some of those benchmarks? Do you remember?
Shooting a video.
Oh, you felt like a rapper.
Yeah, for sure.
You were like, we are out here rapping.
For sure. We're laying out in the field in a Van Cortlandt Park trying to recreate the South in the North.
Yo, hold on.
Oh, it was in Van Cortlandt Park?
Hold on. Yeah. This is the most.
That's the Bronx, right?
Yes.
Yeah, it's the
Bronx. That's where, you guys down That's south hilarious. At the time to me, the song Southern Comfort was such authentic Southern fare for me. I was like, this is the South. You guys were in you guys were half a mile from the golf course in Van Cortlandt in the Bronx.
That's not even the South Bronx.
No.
That's very Northeast Bronx.
No, Northwest Bronx.
Northwest, yeah.
Found a little field and, you know. Yes.
Made it feel like down south.
They weren't, hold on real quick, the label wasn't willing to do the trip back to Richmond to do the video?
No.
They said, let's do it right here.
I mean,
6-hour drive.
I feel like that's easy. Now,
just to get feels though, the one thing though, let's say the photo shoot, which was great, we actually went upstate New York to film that.
Also south. Yeah, that's also the south.
It's south of Buffalo.
South of Canada for sure.
No south, you know what I mean?
So, yeah, I just imagine that feeling when you guys doing a video and you're doing like, did you have food? Were there
craft services?
They had craft services, you know,
and a stylist. So
trailer.
Yes, we did.
Wow,
we did.
What was the dream back then, though? Like, hip hop wasn't as big as it is now. Obviously,
yeah, that's a good question.
Like, what you got signed? What's the ultimate
measuring stick? Yeah,
like to be Tribe. You know what I mean? Like
we were definitely of the native tongue. You know, I mean, obviously we had some bleeding with Snoop, you know, and that's where the whole tractors, rakes, and hoe, like, you know, He was definitely, but even Black Sheep was pushing that too, right? Mm-hmm. So I think overall, I mean, you're not thinking about platinum, gold, like, right. You know, and obviously that's in play, right? But it's just to be known by as many people. That's right. The general, you know, thing. Why you signed to a major, quote unquote, the difference between going into, you know, having an independent record deal and stuff like that. And, you know, but.
And then like the to dream. Be able to do shows, like what, correct. Like what was a big show for you?
Oh yeah,
500 people, like doing tramps.
But the fascinating thing, though, by the time we finished the album and the single was released, the video, we ended up getting dropped from the label. Not too. I mean, they supported us on it, right? Like the story that L told you all about the bus. It was funny. You know, he mentioned, but we were on that bus. So
you did be Jay-Z.
So he said Jay-Z.
Yeah, but I was but in my mind. So yeah, you could say he was on the bus, but I didn't know. I didn't even know Jay-Z was on the bus till L tells the story.
Wow.
You know what I mean?
Right.
So, but I remember Buster coming in the back when he talked about the radio and coming back from Morgan State. And the song becomes not the words, but everybody was tired.
Oh, you remember that too?
Yeah, exactly.
Wait, it really played the whole fucking ride?
Yeah, back. Yeah, and it, to the point where people were tired of ultimately, they weren't tired of the, like, happy for them that, Busta, because this is leaders, obviously, probably was the dominant group on the bus.
Right.
You know what I mean? Popularity-wise. Right.
Yeah.
So, but by the time we were coming back, and they played it over and over.
You know what makes this story?
That's crazy. And it was and by the point, the chorus went,
No, he said, come on, get down, something like that. Yeah.
And so most of us would go, nah, provide background.
What were you doing? It was a show in Atlantic City or something?
Baltimore. So Morgan State. It was a promo show.
It was a Morgan State promo show.
Correct. That's why all the the artists were on the bus. It was a promo show.
Warner Electric Atlantic.
Yeah.
Electric.
Shout out to 88.9 in Baltimore, Morgan State. Mm. My boy DJ Lil Mike. They were our friends / radio rivals, except they had an actual signal.
Did they play Big Chuck album?
Papa Chuck. That's Papa Chuck. Now, hold on, real quick. The reason I love the story that he just told is that it's so valid for me that you told us everything that happened, but you also honestly said you had no recollection of Jay-Z being there. You know what I mean? Because if you were telling a good fib version of the story, you have to include that Jay-Z was there. Yeah. But you're like, to be honest with you, I didn't even know that was Jay-Z.
Yeah.
Because honestly, who would have really cared?
Jay-Z wasn't that big back then.
Right. Why would he care?
There was probably a bunch of entourage rappers, guys that were with the rappers.
Who else do you remember actually being there besides leaders?
Leaders, Artifacts, I don't remember that. Whoever he said, I don't remember. Because we knew the Artifacts, leaders clearly, you know, popular. If I can think about it,
it was really just a myriad of, you know, random.
Yeah, yeah. And when he said those artists, I can believe. Yeah, yeah, it was a lot.
Because even when he told the story, he said, if you want to listen a couple episodes back, El the Sensei from the Artifacts, you should check it out.
Artifacts are a great group, by the way.
Because remember, he said that somebody yelled from the back of the bus. He's like, yo, L.
Yeah.
And he's like, who that? Like, you can't say that today. You would know Jay-Z's voice today.
Right.
But back then, he was just, you don't know who it was.
He was a guy.
But no, that was the front. He said, you talking about coming back?
Coming back. He's like, play the song.
That was the front. No, he did say he was in the front.
On the front. Or yelling to the back.
Yeah. But even like, let's say we had seen Ski Beats. But like, I know Ski now, but Original Flavor.
Original Flavor.
You know what I mean? It's like.
Wait, you just validated the story even more. You don't remember Jay being there, but you remember Ski being there?
They were part of the whole
thing. Because Ski's in Original Flavor,
correct,
of course.
Correct.
Fire. Yeah.
So, you know, hey. But, I mean, look, Hawaiian Sophie's the only way that I knew Jay-Z, I think, technically. To the
end. Wanted to know something that I'm ashamed of? I don't remember Hawaiian Sophie.
You're a little younger.
Yeah, I remember Big Daddy Kane.
Which was amazing, man.
But Hawaiian Sophie was not Big Daddy Kane. I understand that, but, like, I don't remember rapping Duke the Ha the Ha. I mean, I don't remember.
Well, Hawaiian Sophie
was
a New York
thing. That was one of the first rap songs to learn.
I know. How old are you?
50, about to be 51.
Okay. Yeah, well, that's fair. That's enough of an age difference. Do you remember rapping Duke? Coming out?
I wasn't aware of release dates at the time, but it was on the radio.
You remember hearing
it.
The radio?
Yeah, I heard it, yeah.
I only knew it from like a compilation.
Yeah, but I grew up in the Bronx. Like, it's different. You grew up in
you're
the suburbs.
You're from the Bronx?
I used to DJ for Little Kim.
You used to DJ for Little Kim?
like, hip-hop, like, I always say this, like, hip-hop was just around everywhere.
I know.
It wasn't like...
Not Chevy Chase.
Bro, like, if you walk on Fordham Road, every other block had some kind of store that sold some kind of music, and there'd be speakers in the street. You know what I mean? It wasn't like the suburbs. Like, there was always music.
Don't you wish you could just go back?
Oh, I beg to go back.
Honestly, what would you do? Like, how much of a dream would it be if, like, let's suppose, God forbid, you tragically walked out of this apartment and were run over by a truck, which, unfortunately, in New York City is a real possibility.
Yeah, yesterday, so the U-Haul?
Well, that was crazy.
Crazy.
Shouts to Vision Zero. But let's suppose that happened.
Okay.
And in the second that Cipha Sounds became dust.
Yeah.
You got to like have a moment that felt like a long time.
Yeah.
Where you went back.
Right.
Can you imagine how ill it would be to be back in like 1985 New York?
Nah, I'm doing 90.
You want to jump all the way to 90?
90. 90 is where I would go right to 90.
Why 90?
I don't know. It's just like a you know, OCD. It's like just an even year.
Okay.
Of when I was of
you're
age.
You're allowing your OCD to determine where you're going to go when you
it's
die
part of
for
me.
A
it's
brief
in my
time.
Soul. I go right to 90. I'm in Tribe right there.
They're almost there.
Nubian.
You're kind of waiting for Tribe. You're
yeah.
Like,
but I know they're coming.
Yeah, De La's out.
Yeah, right there, 90.
So nice. Do you remember any other, that was obviously a legendary one, but do you remember any other promo shows? Because I have to imagine most of your guys' tour experience was promo stuff,
yeah, it was
right?
Promo stuff. I mean, we went to Atlanta.
Promo means you weren't getting paid. You were just.
Correct. They sent you that. They paid for you to be
they
there.
They paid there so yeah. You could tell people the album was coming out.
Correct. We went to Atlanta.
It's like Instagram.
I think they sent us.
That's right.
Thank on you. Our own, we went to Jack the Rapper prior to getting signed. Nice. And I think they sent us there, you know, on a promo tour.
Right.
You know what I mean?
But you felt way cooler going there as a rapper than when you were just there trying to get signed.
When we were paying for ourselves coming down the highway, you know.
What promo items did they make for Down South?
The main thing that I think they made the vinyl. It was and it's not that's not promo, but it's they made it white, you know, like a
oh yeah
vinyl and stuff.
There's
like
a
that.
White Down South vinyl.
Yes,
album or single?
Album, yeah, and I think it's a double album too.
I have the double album, but I think mine's just black. I think.
Yeah, man, you missed out.
That's sad. Were there T-shirts?
No.
Wow. Damn.
No. Yeah. Now, because I mean, soon thereafter, you know, we got released from the label. You know, it's. You learn that in the business, you know what I mean? Like a bunch of people get signed and the whole goal is to get to, you know, maybe two to pop off and the rest of tax write-offs. You know what I mean?
Did you guys get to a second single?
No.
Damn.
Just Southern Comfort.
Southern Comfort.
Southern video. Comfort was good though.
Yeah. Thank you.
You know how many copies you sold?
No.
Who knows that? Nobody knows
not
that.
Not enough.
They're not going to tell you the
not,
truth.
Not
what
enough.
Was,
well, I bought one. Okay.
Thank you.
On the label, like the other
you
tax
kept
write-offs.
On a day, extra day.
There you go.
Like what other groups were part of like the 5, 6, 7 that got signed around that time?
You had Double X Posse.
Double X Posse.
Right? So Artifacts. Artifacts had the buzz with the label.
Right.
And then you had like, because it was a dance label too, so you had like Robin S.
Mm-hmm. She had some joints.
Yeah, so.
I can't believe this happened to me. Right in front of my face.
Well, that's finally. Oh. And that's CC Peniston.
Ah, yeah.
You're so disappointing.
Yeah, but also too, with Big Beat, Rob Reef Too Low became the A&R midway through the project. You know what I mean? So
what, like Reef. As opposed to Stretch?
Stretch, yeah. Stretch went on to do
left.
Whatever.
Yeah,
yeah, correct.
Oh, okay.
Correct.
So the A&R switch.
It. Yeah, he picked up.
So, but he was still up. Your boy.
Yeah, yeah.
Rob, Reef
well,
was
we met him through that. That well, yeah. Obviously, but we met him through that process. But
man, hanging out back then, man.
Yeah. But the thing too that for me as a producer, because I came to New York to be a star, you know what I mean? But it's interesting, like one particular verse, The Business from
Common.
You know, no, from Tribe album with Diamond
D. Show Business, mm-hmm.
Show
yes.
Business, right? So when he talked about want to make cheese about a couple of G's, like making money as a producer, I was like, okay, I didn't even think about it, right? I came to rap, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But then as we were on the label, Stretch and Reef, they were encouraging me to, hey, you know, you may have something with the production thing. Just you should do that. You know what I mean? You should, you know, develop that a little bit more. So, you know, shout out to them. And then they put me around the Beat Nuts and, you know, T-Ray, like, I was sitting at the feet of these guys who were like, you know, they're like, coming
did you
up.
Watch T-Ray make
yeah, yeah.
certain records that yeah. we love, like Wrong Side of the Tracks or something like that? Like,
I don't know if I, I wasn't necessarily with him, but I would go, or, you know, record shopping still, or yeah. like go to their house or whatever, learning, you know, so I was just, my thing was I wanted to learn, like I rapped, but then I was so fascinated with the music side
yeah, of course.
That I was asking so many questions, going to Vic's house and Juju's house and you know what I mean? Like, so it was good.
Shouts to VIC. Were you, by the time things fell apart for the group at the label, were you already
say it like that? Wow,
yeah, that was the truth, though.
That's harsh.
Listen, there's different levels. Like, we had to, like, you have a conversation about Artifacts. We deem them to be very successful because they dropped two amazing albums. They see it in a somewhat of a different way. Like, yeah, it was great, it was successful, but they didn't go to the next place.
Right,
Down South didn't even make it.
We made it out the gate,
so you out the gate, but you didn't make it to where Artifacts.
So you dropped the single. You dropped the album, and yep. then they dropped you.
Yeah. Ooh.
Oh, ooh. See, now you said it good. That you're a poet. That's why you can hear
you're
on the radio.
Supposed to be sensitive to me, man.
Exactly. Now, so by the time you guys were done at the label, were you already starting to do outside stuff? So at least you felt like I'm good.
No, man. Right after that, you know, my past would say disappointment is not based upon what you find; it's based upon what you expected to find. And we expected to come and do and went through like a little depression where I remember like,
of course,
that's when we started picking up smoking weed and stuff. It was just, oh man, we get this and we just, you know what I mean? It was a phase, you know what I mean? And, but I still love producing and, you know, all of that stuff. But eventually I moved on. I was, you know, I have to do something. Right. And my dad, you know, initially it worked at the post office. So, I mean, he's like, boy, you got to get a job. You know what I mean? Can't keep supporting you being up there, right? So then I had applied to the post office down the street.
Oh, right here. Wow. Yeah, sure.
Had the
or
job.
In Midtown, right?
Had the job. And then because of the relationship with Reef and Mad Skills at the time, he was on the label. I didn't know Mad Skills in Virginia. And then he came here. And then through the relationship.
Wait, he's from where?
Richmond.
The home of Sandman's Comedy Club.
That was. First of all, both of you. Lose 1 point because I was referencing the name of his first album.
Oh, we know.
Oh, you did know.
With question mark, question mark,
yeah.
Question
from
mark.
Where?
I got it.
Did you?
Yeah. No. But so you didn't know him in Virginia.
No.
But when he was up here, you guys connected, had a connect of Richmond. Yeah.
He literally, by choosing the songs, you know, literally saved me from working at the post office. He that decision established me as an independent
you did
producer.
Beats. For that
three,
album.
Three songs.
Which ones?
Inherit the World, All In It, and Street Rules.
So three album cuts for Mad Skills. Yeah.
How long did you meet, before you met him, did you do beats for him? Like a year or two?
No, like, you know.
Oh, right away.
Because he was in the process. And, you know, Rob was soliciting. You know,
oh, so Rob was this guy that used to be in a group I had on sign. He's a good producer.
Yeah, check
he's actually from Richmond. You should meet him, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah, it was cool.
So how much did you get for those beats?
About 3 G's a piece, so you can imagine.
And so you leave with 9 G's.
So you tend to get half up front, so you can imagine.
Yeah.
I was about to work it. I had the job.
Yeah.
They were calling me.
Yeah.
I was getting ready to go through orientation.
Mr. Right? Period.
Yes.
We need you to come in to work.
To post office and wear those clothes, you know, nice,
right.
nice mm-hmm. outfit. And then 4,500 comes, and it's like.
I'm rich, bitch.
4,500 will, like, if you keep it light, you know what I mean? Your bills will get paid.
Yeah,
pizza and ramen.
Yeah, exactly.
And you're Gucci.
You could hold it down for a while.
And with Mayor's family, though, so that was even better.
Oh, like, no rent.
You didn't have rent.
Yeah. Low, or minimum.
Right.
I mean?
Now, here's something I always think about that's got to be kind of awkward. You're the producer in a three-man group, and you start doing beats for other people, and they're at the post office, right?
Like, no, they were
different than
Verizon, and then Mario was, I think, starting to work at Fat Farm just as an employee.
Right.
Yeah, no, that was, and we're still living in the same house, and you know, we just had some differing opinions on some, you know what I mean? But it kept it cool enough to where we could live together. But,
yeah,
right.
You know, and then.
But did they still hang out and go to the studio with you or go to clubs?
Oh, wow.
No.
That's so crazy. We were starting to, you know. And also, too, I had taken some advice.
Sucks, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, and that's why I said the people in the business, different people can come around you and kind of have your mind looking at your people who day one you rock with looking at each other differently.
Yeah.
You know, and that, I know that happened to me where I'm like kind of seeing viewing them a certain way and then they're seeing me a certain way and it, I mean, they rock, they were rocking together and I was kind of just doing my thing.
I mean, yeah, it's survival, it's ego, it's a myriad of things that it could be where like you're young, impressionable, and then like, you know, whoever was working with you, you know, they're like, oh, come do beats for this thing. And they know, look, a lot of times groups don't last. Here's another way for you to, at least you to get in. Yeah. What are you not doing?
You look to them like, damn, now y'all are lost in Brooklyn. But me, I'm good.
I'm out here. I'm going to studios.
Dude. And I mean, but you had to think, man, like that, it was bad. It was ignorant of me to even, you know, looking back at it, right? But at the time, you're young. You're like, you know.
What I'm was doing, ignorant of you?
Just how I handle, like, the information, you know, just people trying to pit us against each other, right? Who were around us. And I, you know, kind of fell for it. I was like, okay.
They're jealous of you.
Yeah, I mean, all of that nonsense, right? And I remember Bob Power. I met Bob Power. Bob Power called me.
It's a big name flex, Bob. It's a drop. Huge, the name dropper.
Name dropper. Name dropper.
Okay. And he called me and left a message on the answer machine. And we still, and I remember playing it like, hey, Sean, this is Bob Power, blah, 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 whatever he said. And I just remember feeling like, yeah, you know, I got, you know, man. I'm over here, like, you know, and they're doing their things. But I'm like, dude, I love these guys, man. And it's like, and we're totally good, right? Yeah. But that's why I said, just in the business, man, not to make it serious, but it's just, bro, like, it seems like people come out of the woodworks. And I'm like thinking of all the people that were around us, other than the stretches, we know. But like, so many people were around us, we only...
So you did the three album cuts on Mad Skills album. And the Fromware album wasn't huge.
Right.
Obviously Nod Factor was a thing.
Right.
That's a great record through and through, by the way.
Yeah, thank you.
And did you get to be around a lot of it, by the way? Like, did you get to meet Q-Tip and...
Not at the time.
Okay.
You know what I mean? But not that was...
Where was the studio? What, remember what studio you did it in?
I want to say Unique, okay. But 40s. That probably is not right. You know what I mean? Because I'm trying to think where Rob would have been.
That area had all the little studios. Yeah. And did you ever get the back end?
Oh, yeah.
You got the 45.
Yeah, that album came out. As soon as your three songs are on there.
So what's the next thing after Mad Skills?
Mad Skills.
Artifacts?
I think it was Artifacts, yeah.
And which ones did you do on the first album?
And let me actually give this a shot because this is important. Right before Mad Skills, I don't know how I got the connection where, but I'm with Vinnie Mojica. She was signed to Warner Brothers, supposed to do an album, so starting to work with her.
Okay, that's the girl singing on...
Versus from the Abstract?
Yeah, right?
Saturday also.
And
she's on the
Saturday?
Tribe album, too.
Right, she's on Low End Theory. Right. Is it Versus from the Abstract?
Oh, that's her singing on Saturday? I never knew that.
I think it's her. Vinny.
Wow.
Yes.
By the way, she's
her
come up...
Her name is Ia now. At the time, she had changed.
Is she also the voice on Quali's The Blast?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. I think that's her, yeah.
She's popped up like on a handful of major rap records.
Yeah.
I have never met her or seen her, but I've heard she's very hot.
Mm. Pretty.
That is a true story, right? Ooh. Everyone said Vinnie Mojica was...
Hey. On the show?
Do you ever meet her?
I don't know.
Her smile, bro.
Yeah. The way people talk about her,
really?
She sounds like angelically beautiful.
Yeah.
I'm throwing around hot loosely. I'm joking.
Okay.
But you haven't heard this from everyone?
No, I never heard this.
Tight curly hair. It was like, what?
Yeah, she's like the image. She's like the image of like native tongues, Arab, beauty, cool, soulful hip hop chick.
Yeah.
Wow. For sure. Okay. I'm in.
So now tonight you have someone to think about.
Yeah.
When you're hovering over those different.
Hover.
Yeah, when you're hovering. So you worked with Vinnie on her project?
Yeah.
But it never came out, right?
No.
What label was she signed to?
Warner Brothers.
Signed to Warner Brothers.
Only because I remember the contract.
Really?
And you got paid?
First half, yeah.
There you go. Okay,
cool. So what was that? I'm just trying to see how your money's going up. Same price?
I think it's about the same. Yeah.
Three, 4 grand?
Yeah, that was the average
for... That's crazy. Like, you got a check for $4,500. You're like, I made it. Then you got the second half. You're like, I'm rich.
Yeah, and unfortunately, man, looking back, I wish I would have just been more wise.
I know, man.
Into investments and stuff. You know what I mean?
You think I'd be considered a cultural appropriator if I named my daughter Vinia?
No.
You think I'm good?
Yeah.
It's a pretty name.
Yeah.
The whole thing's pretty. Vinia. Mojica.
Mojica.
I mean, I can't take her last name. That would be a stretch, but.
Vinia's nice.
I'm trying to get the list of, guest appearances. Versus from the Abstract.
Mm-hmm.
Magnificent with Mos Def in 2002.
Magnificent. I don't even know that one.
De La Soul, a roller skating jam named Saturdays.
How many days of work?
That's five sizes.
And what about how many days to play?
There's only really one.
One whole day to play.
Now, and we also, we, by the time this comes out, it's already, the news is over a week old, but obviously, of course, thinking about Trugoy.
Trugoy, right.
Kind of hard to mention De La and not think about that. Oh my God, she was also on Searching by Pete Rock and CL Smooth. Oh. I did not know that.
Man.
She was, well, okay, I'm starting to get a little freaked out by some of these things. Are these accurate? Should I trust Wikipedia?
Yeah, absolutely.
Always. You're right, absolutely. Cannot be wrong. Okay, Helter Skelter Therapy? I didn't know that. Pete Rock, Mind Blown, I know. Mind Blown Decisions. She was on Climb on Black on Both Sides.
Climb?
She was on, I don't remember that record.
I don't even know that song.
Should we listen? Now, fine. You know what? Fine. You want? Fine.
Climb.
Yeah, now we're going to listen to it.
Who did that?
Climb. Moose. Here it is. And she's listed on it on Spotify.
What's her name listed as?
Vinnie Mojica.
Oh, yeah, because she changed her name to Ia, too, so that's why.
Oh, yes. I love this song. I didn't know it was called Climb. That's so weird. Is it called Climb on there?
It's called Climb. People climb. Did you ever... Well, you don't have any close association with Rawkus, so why would you know these things? Okay, what else is here? Hold on. I remember this, The Blast, of course. She was on Take That, the Beat Miners off their album.
Her voice in the
She's
Blast.
She's on The Sun God by Common. What did she do on The Sun God?
Oh, no.
Gosh. I'm happy to see that she did that much stuff, man. Like,
more than I remembered. Yeah, I would have said it was like a handful. It was much more than a handful.
Here we go. Five songs a day. One whole day. Yeah, this is not really a song. It's almost like an interlude.
It's like an interlude.
But I remember it now.
Okay, so you worked on Vinnie, then what?
And
Artifacts?
Then Artifacts, yes.
Which songs did you do on Artifacts?
The second album. So did about half of the second album.
You really jumped in, because that Artifacts, let me tell you something.
When we were talking to Elder Sensei, he made a very great point.
What's that?
That sound on the second album is the jump-off point for that lane, that sound, like that... mid-late 90s underground, which created the Rawkus sound.
It really is.
You created the Rawkus sound, whether you get credit for it or not. Well, you don't get credit for it.
So wait, you agree with the sentiment that Shawn J Period and Artifacts on this album, you think, really helped kind of usher in the underground sound of the late 90s?
Okay, well, let's hear the story, and then I'll get into it, because I want to know how you met Mos.
No sample here, right?
Yes, it just chopped. I was still sampling.
You were still sampling.
Yeah,
we'll get into why you eventually stopped sampling. Sure. Artifacts, man. Shoo. Okay, which other ones do you do on here?
Where Your Skills At. That's one of my favorites.
Where Your Skills. Let's hear Where Your Skills At for a second. Damn, you did some joints.
What is that? What did you use to make that? Same machine?
EPS and SB1200. And I got my SB1200 from Vic. I bought that from him.
That's DLC. Another flex. Got a call from Bob Power. Mm-hmm. Got an SP from Vic.
And this is Chaos scratching. Man, he needed to put some like deoxin on that. You get
you hear static on it?
Yeah. It's good though.
Artifacts, be the best in this.
Okay, now
the best. Rest any intentions we here to mention. We the fresh. Newark native.
Cipha, you're 100% right. This sounds like, in many ways, it sounds like Rawkus. It sounds like Fondulum. It sounds like a lot of records you'd hear in Fat Beats.
Right.
Glorious time.
And Where Your Skills At.
That was Where Your Skills At.
What's the... I can't think of the name of it.
You didn't do the interview?
Yeah, put it on. No. Put Shazam on.
See if that works.
I'm just trying to think of it.
You're going to make me look on Wikipedia? Because I'll do it if I have to.
Man.
31 Bum Rush is what I'm talking
about. 31 Bum Rush. There we go. This one's dope.
It's like group should book, I still jam like Sam Cook. Took a whole click out and had the sound man flipping with the wicked freestyle and shit on niggas with the rip. All these records have like, I don't know, it's like, what is this, 95? 96? 95, right?
96, I think.
95, 96, it ushered in a new sound that like was so crisp to cut.
I'll tell you when it is, Sife.
Years ago. This was years ago, bro. Years ago.
Yeah. It's so crisp.
And sound wise, though, it was Duro. That's when I also met Duro. Oh, yeah, Duro. I mean, he like.
Yeah, I remember. I remember they were saying that. El Sensei said.
El Sensei told us about Duro too.
Duro, yeah, he his mixing was like, we don't know at the time, we're just living in it, but listening back, it definitely was changing the sound.
Yeah, he's definitely part. I mean, I chose the sounds, but he really took them to the next place. You know what I mean? So.
Okay, so. That's Them comes out. Artifact, like, did you deem, I'm just curious, was the song Art of Facts deemed to be, like, successful by you guys? Like, I have no gauge for that. Like, to me, it's a classic, but, like, what did you guys think?
I mean, one thing I remember is that, in my mind, yes, because it really, for me as a producer, it was the one where people were like, oh, it was the, right. They pay attention. Like, the Maskil stuff, people heard, okay, nice. But that was the one. It was a single, so
yeah. When you get really a single, changes. Single, yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh, that's your first single.
Yeah, first single.
Wait, did you do Southern Comfort?
I did, but I don't. Okay. I count that different. That's more
your group. Yeah. Yeah,
and as we established, I'm the only person who heard that song.
Nah, I used to play. Yeah.
No, I did the videos on the box.
But he bought it. You know what I mean?
Yeah. So, I mean, listen,
you.
I support.
Thank you, man. You understand.
It was, but it was on the box. It was on Rap City. It was on
they,
all that
they
stuff.
They played it around.
But Artifacts was like a real. Like, I don't consider Southern, in my memory, and it's limited to some New York radio and some DC radio, I don't remember Southern Comfort being a super regular mix show record.
No.
Artifacts was a mix show record. Right. Like, people were playing it.
Yeah.
Fun record to cut up and bring back the beginning of.
Right.
And then what did that lead to next after Artifacts?
I want to say it went to, the working with the Boot Camp Click and all of that stuff like that.
Oh, you're on the For the People album?
Before I did Place to Be on Helter Skelter.
On the Helter Skelter album.
So, and then we had a road manager, Joey, who she introduced me to, she knew Evil D. So she worked at Tavel and Thea, which is like a business, you know, business management type thing. So she was, you know, just, hey, meet this person. So she introduced me to Ian Walt, and then also met Baby Paul. And then Baby Paul... was both of them, all of them were pushing me. Hey, you know, Drew and, you know, Buckshot, hey, check this guy out.
We should get Ian Walt on the show. Yeah, have we ever had Evil D on the show?
No, we're losers.
You know what?
We're losers.
Evil D is in the mix. We shouldn't even do the show anymore.
I know. I don't know what we're doing.
I love Evil D.
What are we crying about? I'm crying about my depression. What are we doing?
Every week, because like, there's someone like Evil D and Walt.
Yeah. He's this.
Amazing guys.
And also Evil's so important because not only is he a sick producer and a sick DJ, and he had a show at Hot, right?
Yeah.
Hot for several years.
Yep. Yes.
So he had the Hot radio show. We had radio shows everywhere. Mm-hmm. That Beat Miners radio, the early radio shit they were doing online. Mm-hmm. I don't remember. I think I'm fucking up the name of it. What was the name of his online show?
I don't remember. But I know what you're talking
that
about.
That was the first streaming shit I ever really listened to was Evil D.
Like, how did we listen to it?
Fucking Real Player or whatever? Bullshit like that on the computer.
You had to go to a website.
Yes. Yeah. And I think there was video too. And it was nasty
crazy.
Looking.
How are we doing that?
Yo, Evil
that's
D.
So crazy. Getting in, man. So, y'all, next one. Y'all get them up here.
Yeah, we'll get them up
here. Yeah, we'll get Evil
D. I'll tell him to come the right day also.
No, I know.
Sorry, make sure he comes the day before and knocks on the door.
Yeah.
And then calls you.
And then make sure you put the day on there.
Include the day. Include the day. all right, so you but do boot camp shit.
But hold on, real quick. So you do Mad Skills, you do
Vinia Mojica.
Vinia. Mojica. I got it. That's it. I got it now. Vinia. And then Artifact. How much time is this? Like a couple months in between? This is within a year?
Within a year.
Okay, so like you were still running around shopping beats. Maybe someone didn't take anything, but you'd still be in the mix.
Right, and the low-hanging fruit because, let's say, Mad Skills and Artifacts, because I already knew Rob.
Right.
Big B, that's low-hanging fruit. It's like it's an easier connection with the A&R, whereas the other A&Rs that, like, you know, meeting E through Joey, then that took us to Drew High and, you know, et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah.
So going around shopping,
hustle.
Yeah, it's a hustle for sure. Yeah. But then she also introduced me to Mr. Man from the Bush Babies, and that's how we get into
Mos Def.
Mos Def.
We should get Mr. Man one
it's
day too.
It's literally like I'm literally listening to your story, watching every step. How this guy leads to this guy, to this guy, leads to this guy. It's crazy.
Sure.
Mr. Man, Bush Babies. Do you do anything on the Bush Babies project?
I did. So on the Gravity Hour, I did the intro outro. That's how I actually met Mos, because he was there to do poetic rap type stuff mm-hmm. on the intro outro, and then I did God Complex and Melting Plastic.
So was, pardon my ignorance, mm-hmm. like in some ways was the emergence of Mos Def him just being homie of the Bush Babies?
No, he was making his rounds, though.
He was already making rounds.
Was he
rounds?
On De La first? De La. He was on three Stakes Is High first.
He was on, because this is 96, same year.
The reason, okay, I'll tell you where I met Mos Def the first time. De La Soul album release party at the Palladium.
Mm-hmm. I've heard about
so
this.
So I had met De La previous to that. And you know, I missed the name dropper. So then, so I remember, because that was the night Tretch tried to fight De La.
Oh,
Tretch, because I'm in the DJ booth. I maybe it was Big Cap DJing, and De La performed, and then Mos was waiting on the side by the DJ booth because he was about to go out and be introduced. And I was like, "Who's this guy?" And they're like, "Oh, that's Dante." You know what I mean?
You're talking about Black Dante. You didn't call him Black Dante though.
No, I just called him what they introduced him
but
as.
I'm just saying his nickname was Black Dante.
I wouldn't say that until I was comfortable.
Okay, good.
And then so yeah, so then he goes out and performs. I'm like, "Yo, that guy's fire." And then I didn't say fire back then because that's more of a modern slang.
Yeah, yes, but right. Then that guy's dope.
Yeah, then Tretch and a whole bunch of Jersey dudes like were going through the crowd and like, who's these guys going to?
What was the beef between De La and Naughty?
There was a line De La had. There was something they said about Tretch. It was like a little slick line. I don't think it was a diss. It just a slick line.
By the way, De La underrated for their little slick lines.
Oh man,
yeah. They were slickers.
Trugoy and Paz are down to throw in a little, just a little quickie smart.
Yeah, tuck all over your tracks like Pete Brock and Sean Puffy. Like if you're Puff, you're like,
what
is that?
When you said Pete Rock and Sean Puffy comes,
yeah,
because it's kind of because Pete's kind of like, wait, but do you mean it's a good thing or a bad?
That's what I'm saying. But like the Pete ones,
but you felt Pete had more license to talk all over the track because he was doing the track.
Puffy
was like,
and all he was saying was,
yeah, and then like, yeah, right.
It's the executive like, talking over the track.
That's yeah, it was like, is that a diss? I don't know, but it's a good song. So
Stakes Is High first, you're saying. So he was already moving around when this, and here's the intro you're referring to. Let's hear this. I've never listened to the Bush Babies album. Admitting it right now. Just the singles.
You did this.
You did the cuts too?
No. But that sample. Cuts. Yeah, gravity
is all the. This is a sample?
Sample, but played. I chopped a sound and then played it out.
Right. Just when you thought you strayed far away, here come gravity to save the day. Here come gravity to save the day. Here come gravity, gravity, definition. Now plural.
Well, I'm a little disappointed with myself. There's a Q-Tip record on here. I never listened to it.
There's a bunch of records on there. Paz, the single on it.
Yeah, I remember there was one with Paz, and then of course, I mean, this is the joint that I. This was everybody. This was a thing. Shake it
down. Oh yes, oh yes. I never listened to this album either.
I want to listen to the whole album now.
I'm actually
It's kind of weird. There's Q-Tip, there's Paz, there's Mos. There's a lot of shit on here.
Should we get the Bush Babies? I don't know anything about the Bush Babies.
Where are the Bush Babies?
Maybe one is in Florida.
What happened?
I'm not sure. I heard he was in Florida.
Who could we ask? So who else would know the Bush Babies?
Why don't you call Q-Tip?
You think Q-Tip still knows?
Maybe somebody knows.
Okay, question for you, Sy.
Stretch knows.
Question for you. Who's bigger? Mm-hmm. Bush Babies or Artifacts?
Artifacts. Oh.
Nah, I mean, far as... No, let's say above...
Artifacts, ground. They had a... No one... Remember We is bigger than any Artifact song.
Right.
The Bush Babies.
Yes. But the Bush Babies album, we never even listened to it, and we loved the Artifacts album.
Right,
so,
right.
But Remember We, the Salaam remix, was the biggest that I'd say either of them did.
I guess. Yeah.
Yeah. And since you asked early about the two stories, you know, obviously meeting Mos, my Dilla story comes out of that.
Oh, so let's go. We're here now.
We were at Battery Studios working on that. So... Dilla walks through, I guess he's, because Q-Tip is there and all, you know, obviously that's his guy. He walks through in the hall and I meet him in the hall. And I remember, like, Dilla, like, can you imagine? I'm finally getting my opportunity as a producer. These guys are liking my stuff. And then all of a sudden, Dilla comes on the scene and everybody's talking about Dilla.
Yeah. Except they're just calling him JD.
Right. And I'm like, yes, correct. And I'm like,
Yeah.
Hey. Little did you know you were dealing with something different.
But then this is, and I tell his mom this story too. I told it because I interact with them, you know, Marduks and stuff like that. And we were in the hallway, and I know this guy was like, this guy's weird for saying this. I said, bro, I said, to be honest, man, you know, I'm sorry to, you know, to say that. I said, man, but I found myself, man, feeling like jealous of you, man, because, you know, I'm the same story. I'm like, I'm trying to do that, and then everybody's talking about you. Yeah. And he's like, ah, oh, man, it's cool, it's cool, it's cool. And that's it. That's my only time I ever met Dilla.
You told him that
I literally told him that, like, I saw him, and I just was feeling like, dang, man, this thing was eating me up. Because I'm like,
because he's a cool guy, and, and you thought, obviously, you thought he was dope.
Yeah, and he probably thought it was, like, super weird. Like, I'm meeting this guy, and he's telling me he's jealous. And in the streets, like, that could turn into, like, someone jealous. And I'm like, no, it wasn't like, but it was cool, it was cool.
Meanwhile, Dilla's thinking, where's the closest strip club? What are you talking about? I'm trying to go see some chicks.
Yeah, I was having an emotional moment.
Right. I get it.
No matter how much work you do and steady work and you're getting on these albums and you're making money, you're making a name, something like that happens and you're just like, wow, can I get a break?
Dude, and even most. I mean, coming in right after that, the Universal Magnetic, they were like, Bush Babies were trying to come up with the final single. And that night, Bob was mixing. And then I went home, and I'm like, making this track. And then I ended up making the Universal Magnetic track. They didn't choose it, right?
Wow.
And then, you know, Pos came, and he did that particular thing. And then about 2 weeks later, Khalil or Mr. Man brought Mos to my house, and that's when I played him that track. And that's when he picked the Universal Magnetic track, you know. Yeah.
And is that just Mos?
That's him doing the horn right there.
That's just him doing the horn. Yeah.
This is a good set. Man, this thing is going like in clockwork right here.
Okay.
Because I could tell you stories about the horn, you know?
Yes, we want to.
And we want to hear the story. Yeah.
Hold on 1 second. The alphabet.
A, B, boys rock the world. CDs and tapes help generate tapes. E, F is the import of death. G, good. H is what style B. But I grabbed the record from NMC. Roll off the tongue like
this song was out. This is where I became a man. Done, I remember. Will agree.
I was like very much a college kid in this moment. This was such heavy rotation on my radio. Block party. Used to wish I could break the rock. This was like the biggest thing. Yeah, this was the biggest like indie thing of that moment in a lot of ways.
My name is Mos Def,
this is good as it gets, baby. I make you rub your mints like sardines and grits. My shit still hit, even when the record skip, even when the record skip, even when the record skip. I don't quit, I don't quit. We about to make this one.
Wait for it.
Here comes Shawn J, make the party people feel it.
Ladies and gentlemen, I
just saw Shawn J get visibly aroused when that happened. Still hits him that way.
Shut up, man. Come on. Is this a place?
Such a place that creates such a melody.
Brooklyn.
No ladies. It's a living dream. It's a living dream. It's a living dream. Love like this. Recognize all area crew whenever you speak Japanese.
You know what's so crazy about the single?
What?
Is that I remember constantly debating in my own head which side I wanted to play. And you did both sides.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
If you can.
So
you
now
can hear.
This is, so you meet Mos Def through the Bush Babies, mm-hmm. and then he likes your beat that he rhymed over your beat on their album.
Right.
And then you go to his house and he play him this, or your house, mm-hmm. you play him this. Did he already have a deal when you played him this?
No.
He was just making records.
Actually, he was looking for stuff, but then Rawkus had offered him a single deal. That they were new.
Yeah, it was only single new. Deals at that point.
Yeah. So they offered him a single deal. And I remember, great guy, bro. He was just like, whatever they gave him, let's say they probably gave him $2,000.
Yeah.
He was like, hey, we just go split it, and I'll use this song, and I'll use this, you know, this other right. song. If you're home, you can hear. So
it was great. It was great, man.
And how long did you guys knock it out in one day?
We recorded the Universal Magnetic. We actually started out at Skef Anselm's house, who's, you know, of the tribe.
Oh, shit. Skef Anselm, he gets props, too.
He does. He gets props. So we were in the Bronx.
What did Skef do?
I was just about to say, who is Skef Anselm?
Maybe an engineer.
Yo, Cipha, we need to get Skef Anselm.
I think it was an engineer, right? Or something.
That's what I assumed.
He scared you?
Bro, I did not see you go to...
Yo, Cipha,
that door's locked, yo.
Cipha, that was very racist.
What?
that a black gentleman walks to the bathroom.
Let me tell you something.
And you go, oh, what's happening? What the fuck is wrong with you, man?
I did not see any skin color. I just saw.
Oh, yeah.
I don't see color. I just saw a body.
Nobody less racist than me.
I never knew he was. I mean, I didn't know he wasn't back then. And I saw somebody walk in. I was like, oh, we're about to die.
Someone right found out where we are.
Yeah,
I assume Skef Anselm's got to be an engineer also. That would be my.
Yeah, that's what I think. I mean, because, but also too, we went to his house and we recorded the vocals to Universal Magnetic there, and even let's say the beginning part of the drums.
Yeah,
Dave, if you're around Mos or Yassine, or however you know the name goes, Dante. Whatever.
He said I'm allowed to still call him Mos. He told me that.
He dope.
Yeah,
because you've known him since then.
He said you're from the era where you're allowed to still call me Mos. He gave me the pass.
Okay. Now, real quick.
Yeah.
I didn't know him in that era.
Yeah.
But I was a fan in that era.
No.
Can I still call him Mos?
No. Nope. You have to call him
Yassine.
And I call him Dante.
Yeah.
He probably doesn't want that. You know what I mean? But
I'm telling you, I had this conversation with him. Yeah. I go, how do people, what should we call you? And he goes, you call me what you called me when you met me, in that era.
So Dante is what I was.
So you get Dante. Yeah. Wow, Dante. Thanks, privileges.
Man. Yeah, something. Man. Dante Bazet was his acting name, and then.
I don't even think I could call him Dante.
That's like knowing Barack Obama Dante in college Smith. And calling him Barry. You're like, I know him as Barry. Yeah. That's my dude. You know,
it's my guy. So, but it, you know, in that whole thing, it just was great to work with them. So
what were you saying about the drums?
In the beginning, he with him, and you'll notice he gets any instrument he'll come around, he'll just come in the room. If that's an instrument, he's ignoring you for an hour because I'm around an instrument.
He's in a zone, yeah.
So he has to play around with the instrument?
He has to. Yeah. Anywhere he goes. If you have an instrument hanging on your wall.
He's literally the definition of artist.
Right.
Like, that's such a vibe. And sometimes you, like, want to get work done. He's in that art, man. It's just like a feeling, a zone, a sound.
Wow. Yeah.
But then SP was on, like, in the drum. So that those are the drum sounds that, you know, I used in the actual beep. And then he's over there. And he said,
cat,
da, da, da. So he took my drums and played, and then he just started up. He plays it, da, 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 A, B, both. I was like, oh, we have to do that.
Yeah.
Right? So then I put it in record, and
he
played it. And we recorded it. And then he did what he did, and then I started to beat.
And then you start the beat. So that part was just Mos playing with the machine.
The machine.
But I heard that happen a lot. If you listen to Mos Def back then, I always used to laugh. Me and Jared from Rawkus used to be like, Mos always has two intros. There's like this weird, some kind of weird intro, and then the intro, and then the song. And if you listen to his album,
when he performs too. He whistles, doing the whistle thing, and then.
So, because you're right, he does the weird. Are you talking about
the truth?
Everything. There's two intros.
It's true.
Is If You Can Haunt streaming too?
It's gonna be in the tubes.
I don't think it is.
So he did. So whatever it was, who was back?
Oh
then?
Yeah,
Corey was around.
Corey,
right. And he got him some deal at Rawkus with.
I don't know. Corey got him that. Did he get him that deal?
I don't know. I'm just saying.
No. Corey was around, but he was more with Talib. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Right.
Mos came in. You know.
And then he got the deal. Shaka.
Shaka, but Shaka was later. Okay. Shaka never became his manager.
Yeah, he was just around.
Yeah, he was around more like Q-Tip and stuff like that.
Right.
You know what I mean? But since you mentioned Corey, this is a good place to say.
Talking about Corey Smith, the manager of.
At the time, De La Soul.
De La Soul.
Uh-huh. Talib Kweli.
Black Star together,
sometimes, right? Sometimes Mos Def, he helped.
Yeah. And now Dave Chappelle.
Mos Def can't have a manager. It's just like
he tried.
Whoever helps him out, like around that time.
His parents were helping him. And
yeah, Abby,
and then
this is, come on. What is this? This is a sample?
Sample. Brian Auger, Oblivion Express. It's a Herbie Hancock, Maiden Voyage. This is clear, so he owns 30% of the song, so I know.
Bro, this is for life, so we'll rise and give praises. Turn my face to where the mighty sun raises. My book around pages, filled with phrases that amaze.
I could go on for days. First name Dante, last name Bazet. What's his last name?
Bazet, Smith is his government name, quote unquote.
Okay.
Bazet is his acting name.
Dante Bazet?
Bazet, yeah.
First name Dante, last name.
Is that his name when he was on Cosby Mysteries?
Yeah, Bazet. So that was.
Well, when he did Brown Sugar, he was just Mos Def.
No, I'm talking about Cosby Mysteries.
I know. I don't remember Cosby Mysteries.
Well, you're not in the.
And I now would just I would now just refer to them to as NBC series of mysteries.
That's funny.
Okay. So, where exactly were we? I just got excited listening to that song.
We were talking about
to tell a Corey story.
Oh, Corey. Well, yes,
it's actually a story about you. So
here we are.
Is it more racism?
Yeah. No. Oh, this is the parenthetical insertion.
Finally, I get mixed in because Kanye documentary. I'm left out,
chopped out.
Yeah. So you were a part of this particular story, and you didn't even know it, right?
Okay.
So, and this goes into the whole. It can lead into the sampling, but it leads into let's say my name, right? Yeah. Shawn J Period and stuff like that, right? So, I'm in. You know. The guys are gone. I'm working, doing my thing. I'm in Brooklyn. And a friend comes up and says, "Hey, man, you know, I didn't know that you were DJing downtown." I'm like, "I'm not DJing downtown," right? So then I'm like, Corey, right? And I'm like, Corey has one of his assistants or whatever reach out to me. Corey, and I'm like, he said, something about doing a mixtape. And I was like, "I'm not doing a mixtape." Corey talked. He said, "Oh, man, I'm sorry, man. I meant for them to call DJ J Period, but they called you," right? So I'm like, okay. And then it gets to the point, I see you on Sucker Free, and you said, "Straight from the street, Sucker Free, we have SJ Period in the house." And he says, J Period turns to you and says, "No, I'm J Period."
Oh, shit. Right?
You didn't know that. Yeah. But at that point, I was already starting to trademark my name and do all of that stuff like that, right? So I was like, oh, wow. And that's the definition of, confusion in the marketplace is the definition of trademark infringement. So should we go here? It's a happy
ending. No, this is very interesting. I just never thought about it.
It's a happy ending.
Because I didn't know J Period until sort of later. Right. So I never thought about that you guys had crossover time like that.
Yeah.
Where your names were basically the same.
I was in the mix, but I was pulling back. I was, working to get a fam and stuff like that, right? But the blend time, it was almost like mad skills. I'm not mad anymore. It was like this blend, right? So to the point where Corey has people calling me confused, and then to see you say that, SJ Period, he said, "No, I'm J Period," right? His name is Joel, right? So, and I'm like, oh,
that's
wow.
crazy.
So then, going through my trademark with the patent and trademark, office and stuff like that, and I hired an intellectual property attorney and stuff, and then I'm like, we have to do something about this, right? So she issues a cease and desist, right? Because I'm like, hey, this
to
is
J Period?
J Period.
Wow.
Right? So, and I knew she was going to do that. And then eventually he hired. He was like, oh, no, whatever. So he wanted to talk. He said he wanted to talk. So I realized he knew who I was, but he wasn't trying to be me, right? Mm-hmm. So at that point, it's like, and I'm thinking about, man, it would cost a bunch of money. And it's like, obviously I was out first, you know what I mean, using the brand and stuff like that. So we agreed to do a coexistence. We have a coexistence agreement to clear up anything if anyone gets the confusion, oh, no, that's J Period over there, and this is
Shawn J Period, the producer.
Right. But
I've never asked him, why is J Period's name J Period?
And I never even asked him. I never even asked you, how did you come up with your name? I know how I came up with my name.
Yeah, what's yours?
Yeah, well, guess what?
Shawn J, and then used to be just Shawn J, like Steady B, and then college I had, a little bit more mouth. They were like, yeah, send him in there, period to the point, feeling myself a little bit, right? So I added period on, just being period to the point. You know what I mean? So I was that since I was in Richmond. But
yeah, that's
and
crazy.
I never asked him the question. But fun,
I called him SJ Period.
SJ Period. And he turns to you and said, no, but I knew, I'm J Period.
Yeah, but it must have been a slip because I know he wasn't Shawn J Period.
Right. But when you said it, I was
when you hear J Period, that's crazy. Yeah. Wow.
But anyway, I thought since I'm here with you, what I mean?
Yeah, of course.
But it's a happy ending. We're good. I've interacted with
him. I set off a lawsuit.
Yeah, look what you did, Cipha. I just texted him randomly out of the blue. I was like, hey, why is your name J Period? And the real surprise, guess who's in this bathroom right here? Come on out, Jay.
Kelsey, get him.
No, Cipha, you wouldn't be scared because J Period's white. So you wouldn't even react if he walked out of the closet for no reason. That's very interesting, though. I never really put all that together.
Yeah, but we're good, though. We've interacted since then and stuff like that.
Dan, we mentioned Kanye in passing. You and Kanye feel like you had crossover time. Did you guys have interactions or no?
We did it because when I watched that documentary, I literally, can you imagine? So I'm here and I stop putting a bunch of stuff out for various reasons. The sample thing, you know, mainly, really, the scene just kind of pulling back. Had got recently got married at the time. The guys are doing Black Star. I'm not really, you know, involved anymore, right? And then when I watched the documentary, I literally, it's almost like looking at your life.
Yeah.
Because it literally picks up from when they were Black Star, meeting him.
It's right after you.
Like, literally, like months. You know, and I sit and I'm like, and I don't regret my life. Like, I love my life, love my fam and all this stuff like that. But it's fascinating to see that. And no one is going to watch it like that. You know what I mean?
No, of course. I did. It's funny because I watched certain parts of it. I was like, oh, that's when this happened and this happened. Because, but you literally stop and then they're not going to stop because you stop.
Yeah, of course.
So they keep going and then what's the next thing? And if you didn't stop, who knows if they would have been there that day to meet that person. You know what I mean?
For sure.
But hold on, before you talk about how you stop, I just gotta go. So you have, you do the Mos Def singles, and then you did Black Star,
Black Star, Hater Player, and Hater Children's Player. Story,
and Children's Story.
Wait, Children's Story is Black Star?
Yeah.
Oh, that's right. Okay, not Mos Def.
You thought Mos? Oh yeah.
Because I love Children's Story.
What was he talking about on there?
What? Hip hop. It's about Puff and
who? Huh? It was about Puff. You think?
Am I confused?
Man. It was the whole thing. They were kind of in that mode where it's like the Jiggy thing was there and there. But he performed that at the Lyricist Lounge.
Yeah.
And that was right after Big got killed, right? So.
Oh, really?
So he, and first of all, you had to think, why was Puff at the Lyricist Lounge? Like, you know what I'm saying?
Always
like,
was.
Yeah, but I mean, I'm saying, but he at was that time. There. Right. And then. Because obviously he's large, he's exec, he's doing, you know, but most performed that song at the Lyricist Lounge. And right after the show, Puff comes up with some people, then some, you know, some of most, you know, Muslim guys, so they hit kind of some guys with him. And he was like, basically, I don't remember all the words, but like, you need to be more sensitive. You know what this environment is, you know.
I 100% remember that happening.
And I remember being scared because I'm like,
where was it? Where was the Lyricist Lounge? Do you remember?
No, I don't remember. So,
but was it El Flamingo?
I don't know.
Puff said to Mos, you need to be careful in this environment.
Yeah, like how you're saying, you know, because he was basically talking about him sampling. I mean, he was just talking about him sampling. Like, it wasn't
that deep. No, but it wasn't a deep time.
It was a deep time.
It was a deep time.
He stepped to him at, we were outside, and I'm thinking, like, I'm driving y'all home.
Yeah. Your wife big is Moo, there. Was Moo there? Remember Who? Moo, the big security guard that used to be with Mos all the time?
No.
I think he was with Q-Tip at that time.
No.
But it's funny because Puff was always around that. Like, we know Puff is a big record executive that made all these big, big, big hits. But he's an underground head.
Right. Okay.
And he would always be at the underground shows and listening to. He would listen to
my show. That's all I know.
Yeah.
He's ahead. He's very interesting that way. How many other random are we forgetting? Like stuff like this, for example. How many random things are there like this? Nice shout out here too.
You don't stop, baby. Mm-hmm. Shawn J, baby. Yeah.
What?
Period. OC, baby.
OC again?
It's from Lyricist Lounge. Triple vinyl album. This is the one I put off the album.
First style, baby.
Is this post sample?
No, it's still sample, but I was just playing. I was taking notes of everything and playing it. You know what I mean? So
what's poppin', baby? I haven't heard from you lately. We used to conversate day to day on the deli. Remember when I saw
you mean Mos Def? You do a couple records with him, and then he's just calling you. Or you're just hanging with him.
Say it again.
You're just hanging with Mos. Like at any moment, he might need something for something.
Tell me the guy.
No, back then.
Just once we locked in with Universal Magnetic,
that was it.
You locked in.
We were just the guy. We were there. And also too, he had just got recently married to Jeannie. And Mos has a car, but Mos didn't drive.
Mm-hmm.
So I almost was like friend, producer, pseudo driver.
Yeah.
Like, you know
everything.
Like,
yeah.
At that time, you were around Mos Def. People were like, yo, you were the kid down south. You were like, who? Oh, yeah. That's what Cipha used to do. I'm just kidding. So you know what you should do?
What?
We should go over to Patreon.
Now?
I think it's time. Yeah.
But we're right at the juicy.
Okay, it's always a juicy part.
Okay, let's go.
Patreon.com/JuanEppisLife. You can always catch more of our interviews.
It's like $300 a month. It's fine.
It's much less than that. It's $750. It's reasonable.
Yeah.